Yeah, well, thank you very much. Well, you know, it's 2020. This is not exactly the beginning of the year, but it's 2020. And the one thing we should look out for and concentrate on is our mullah, the money man. Somebody says money can speak one language, and the only thing he can tell me is goodbye. Which means no matter how much money he makes, he's always leaving him. Well, today we're going to talk about how do you keep that money? Not just keep it, but how do you make it grow? And that's what we're going to be talking about. And who else can talk about this other than my respected friend, a great man? Put your hands together. Show some love for Mr. Kojo Addae-Mensah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good to see you, man. Yeah. All right. And by the way, money CEO of Databank. Boss. Long time ago.
Yeah, I think it was somewhere in November 2018.
It's been over a year.
It's been a long, long time.
Long time. Things are good.
As they say, Afincheba.
Afincheba. You know, you heard me. We're going to talk about investment. We're going to talk about Databank.
Yep.
We're going to talk about why Databank and many, many other things. But quickly, before I start, I just learned that your father was a sports commentator back then?
In the 70s, he was. I mean, together with, for those who really would know, with Kofi Kumado, who was then also a law lecturer in Legon, Winston Davis, Edward Fachi, you know. I remember those people. I would go in Accra Sports Stadium in the commentary room, little boy like that, watching them do their thing. Yeah.
Because I was just mentioning to a friend of mine, you're coming today.
Yeah.
And I mentioned, I said, wow, your interest in sports just dazzles me. And he said, buy it from his father.
Yeah, I mean, wow. my father is into so many sports. Almost everything I know, I think I took the roots from him. Of course, things have developed since then. So my interest in all sorts of things, you know, soccer, cricket, you know, b-ball, tennis, squash,
Formula One.
That one, he had nothing to do with it. But Formula One is big on me. I'll give that credit to my brother. He started watching it, and I was wondering what's this all about.
Wow. But
I've gotten deep into F1 as well.
And we're going to be talking about that, folks. You'll be amazed how deep he is into Formula One. Those of you saying, "Ah, Formula One," see you there. Well, just stick around. But before we get to that, we'll get back. We'll get to that.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Databank, finance. Sure. You know, there was a cleanup recently, and that led to a lot of dust, and the air is clearing still. How have you fared? First of all, your take on that cleanup, and where do you stand now?
I think it was a necessary evil. From what I know, it's something that had to be done. And I would have wished that it was done quicker and swifter so that all the dust that was popping up would settle. But if you recall, from 2017 in August, there was one round of it. Then again in 2018, August, same, another round happened. Then in November, our industry, the Securities and Exchange Commission, also did another round. So just when there's revocation of licenses and there's nervousness and there's anxiety, and things are beginning to settle, then another one pops up, then another one pops up. I know that they had to do a lot of due diligence and make sure that what they were, the decisions they were making, were the right decisions. But it has cost us quite a bit, because no matter how strong you are, no matter how big you are, no matter how right you are, or you are on the right course, people will still be nervous and are not sure what's going to happen to you next. Are we sure you are safe? What's going on? So It was a necessary evil, but I would have wished it was done quicker. Mm. Be it as it may, I hope, you know, it's over and we can get into this year, focus on what we really need to do for our clients and do the right thing.
Did that hit you in any way?
Sometimes journalists take things differently. But let me tell you how it would affect a company like Databank. So in August, licenses of 347 microfinances, 23 savings and loans are revoked. You have money sitting in a savings and loan. It's August ending. Your school fees bill has come. Schools are opening in September. You had X amount of money in Susu and So Company, and you also have money sitting at Databank. What choice do you have?
Mm.
You have no choice. You just have to come to Databank to take the money because you have to pay your kids' fees. I mean, this is not even about your ordinary monthly bill here and there. This is about the future of your children, their education, your health, whatever it is. Your money is locked up somewhere. The receiver is saying, yes, I acknowledge that your money is in this place. However, I need to go through a procedure or a process before I can pay you back your money. That process will take me X number of months. No school is waiting for you. No school is understanding that, oh, your money is locked up in so-and-so place. Yeah. So in that space, in that vein, yes, it will hit us. We saw people coming for their monies from us. Through no fault of theirs, they need to access their money. So they did access their monies. Some wouldn't bring their deposit that they would ordinarily have brought. So instead of bringing the money to deposit and invest, they would rather use it to meet a certain expense here or there. So in that vein,
And how have you positioned, or how is Databank positioned to protect investors' money in a time like this?
It's all about governance. A lot of it relies heavily on governance and how we are structured to ensure that, you know, the funds of depositors are safe. And at Databank, you know, we have the five products that people know mostly about. They know EPAC, they know M Fund, they know B Fund, ARC Fund, EDI Fund. These are all companies on their own. They are not just products that Databank, they are all companies on their own with their own independent non-executive directors. So apart from EPAC, I'm the only executive director that is sitting on these boards, taking investment decisions. So there's no owner, so to speak, sitting there. These board members are there for you and I, the shareholder who has come and invested, protecting your investment and making sure that we have invested the money where the law allows us to invest the money, in the right way. So you don't have any owner sitting on M Fund board coming to say the company is mine and I'm saying invest money here or invest money there. It doesn't happen. There's none sitting on ARC Fund. You can go and check the annual reports. You can go on our website and check those who are sitting there as board members, sitting there in fiduciary responsibility for you. It's only, say, EPAC that we have one, you know, of our shareholders still sitting there. I must say he's not as active as you would expect because he's not even in management. I'm the only one in management still also sitting on the board. But that is because you always need a bridge between board and management to go and implement the decisions that the independent members have told you to implement. So every month they are checking reports and asking you, where did you invest this money? Did you invest it the right way? Is it according to the law? Is it according to the rules? And they are also invested in the same products and in the same firm. So they will not sit down to allow their monies to go, you know, waste or to get locked up somewhere in an investment that is not right. I'm not saying that every investment is perfect. There are some investments that may or may not go right. But when you have the proper structures in place, you can take the necessary provisions and take the necessary steps to ensure that the money is safe. So we are not a firm that has the owner sitting there issuing instructions left, right. You know, people say the owner comes and says, hey, go to the vault, pull X amount of money, drops it in their boot and drives off. You can never get that at our place. You know, never. Every product and every board has different members. So I'm, you know, speaking every quarter to at least 15 different people. Now, KSM, come on. You think 15 independent non-executive directors will sit down and allow for just one single person to misuse money anyhow? The chances of that happening are like very minute.
Yeah. How could people get away with it though? I mean, if it was something that was happening or something that was rampant, is it because there was absence of structures or?
You see, a couple of things. The structures could be there, you know, but I must admit the companies were many. So the regulator trying to find out what everybody is doing every quarter will not be easy. They are not resourced to that level. And maybe there's something about the entry level. People were saying that to get into a license, was the entry level was too low and all that. But more importantly as well, sometimes, you know, like I always say, when you have owners also sitting on the boards at the same time, it can be tricky. I mean, this is the man paying you, so to speak, and then gives an instruction. Not everybody has the courage to stand up against owners and say, look, what you're doing is wrong, I don't accept it, and I will resign on principle. It rarely happens in Ghana. So I'm just speculating here, but I think it is a factor where two things are happening. Maybe at the level of the board, there are owners also sitting there, also issuing instructions that nobody is challenging. And then, because the industry had grown so rapidly, so quickly, and so huge, the regulator was unable to track and find out if everybody was doing what they actually said they would do. But as an example, you know, in our industry, we're being asked not to, you know, give guaranteed rates. They had said it over and over again. We asked for time. Even yet, while we're asking for time, some of our people were still, you know, going ahead to guarantee the rates. Now, when you guarantee a rate like a bank and you don't have the balance sheet that the banks have, like a bank has 400 million, our, you know, stated capital is now being revised. They are looking somewhere around 2 million. Look at the gap. So if I guarantee you a return and I'm unable to meet it because the investment I made didn't happen, then it means that I have to fall on my balance sheet. I don't have that kind of balance sheet to be able to pay you irrespective of what has happened. So that those are some of the things that people should really look at when, you know, and we always look at the firm and we look at the regulator, but we should look at ourselves as well. As shareholders, we should look at ourselves. We always say, oh, yes, hi, good. They say, this place, oh, they say.
Yeah.
Then we use they say and then we go. We don't ask the right questions. We don't check who is there. We don't check their track record. We don't check their experience. We don't know where they've been, what they've done.
But a bit of those listening, what are the right questions? What people should they be asking? What do they want to?
It's not very complicated. First of all, you have to ask, are you regulated? Do you have a license?
Mm.
Have you filed your returns? Did you file them on time? You know, you can even go to the regulator to check. These people, do they file their returns on time and accurately? Delays are a symptom of issues. When people keep delaying consistently, then you have to start asking, okay, somebody goes in and says, I'm investing 100 CDs. What is the expectation that in about a year, about how much will I be getting? And then you are being given some averages that, you know, today T-bill is at 14.9 or something, and then you are being given double that. You should ask, okay, what is it that you are doing differently? Where exactly are you placing this money? What is it? You know, people are giving answers that, okay, because they want to hear that answer, they accept it. But if somebody gives you 10 percentage points above a risk-free rate, you should really ask some very serious questions. And how come you're able to do this? What risk are you taking? Because, yeah, it could be possible, but it's high risk, high return. So maybe the return is high, but then the risk is equally high. Are you prepared to take that risk? You know, who are the people behind the company that you are putting your money in? What is their track record? Where have they worked before? What is it that they've done? I mean, with all due respect, if you come out, you know, to Databank and you ask who the CEO is, it's somebody who has been sitting in the financial services industry for two decades. You don't just, you know, get there by default. Even if it's a brand new company, you have to check, okay, it's a brand new company, but the person running it, what is that person's, you know, track record itself? So it's not just about the track record of the company. Yes, the company is, you know, 30 years old, but the person running it, what is that? What have they done before? You know, what's their background? You do all those checks and make sure that you are putting your money in the right place. What are the reports? We don't like reading reports. What disclosures are in the reports? Are they really disclosing what it is they are disclosing in? And I always give EPAC as an example, where if you pick the EPAC annual report, you will see which countries in which EPAC has invested, which companies in those countries they've invested. And if you are a serious investor, you even check whether, okay, this company that they say they've invested in, is it really any good company sitting in Nigeria or sitting in Malawi or Egypt or Kenya or wherever it is that we are? If you take M Fund, it will show you which fixed income instruments we've put your money in, 91, 1 year, 5 year bond, ESLA, etc. Disclosures are important. So that is such a huge difference, in my view, between what we do at Databank and what a lot of others do.
Who would you consider your competition?
Oh, yes, that's not. Can I plead the fifth? Okay, but seriously speaking, yeah. I must be honest. There are three of us really, and the three of us, we collaborate a lot. We don't see ourselves as
competitors.
We see ourselves as collaborators because if we don't do that, our industry can crash around us if we start just hitting at each other. So, Databank is EDC and Stanlib. For me, we are the three main investment banks in this country doing, you know, solid fund management business, I must say. But the three of us collaborate a great deal because a lot of our competition has, you know, gone down right around us, and it's not good for the industry.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to collaborate more to grow the industry again, bring back the confidence, and, you know, don't get people putting monies under their beds. And I'm hearing all sorts of things. People are digging, you know, holes behind their houses back to the, you know.
Yeah. Old. In your estimation, how low has the confidence sunk? How much work needs to be done to bring that back up?
A lot of work. Look, if I let's put it that if 2015 was 100% confidence, I'm just using that.
Yeah.
I think today we're at about 20%.
Really?
Yes, I'm not
that
kidding.
Low.
Oh, that low. That low, because and a lot of people don't even see the differences between the microfinance and the savings and loan and the main banks. They lump all of us together. And unfortunately for us, because bank is even attached to our name, it makes the matter worse.
Yeah.
So they lump all of us together, you know, and say, oh, we are not sure when you are next going to be hit. So the confidence is really, really low. And we are going out. We are not perturbed. We'll continue to go out there. We'll continue to educate. We'll continue to, you know, teach people the right thing, give them the tools to know exactly what it is they are doing. Because investing is important. No matter what is happening around us, you still have to invest. One day, you will not be working. You will still need money. You will have to prepare for that time. And you don't have a choice but to deal with a financial institution worth its salt. So, the confidence is very, very low, if you ask me. But hopefully, by the end of the year, we would have brought
it back up.
Maybe 60-70%.
Fantastic. Show so love, man. And we're going to take a commercial break. Let me come back. Let's delve into this. Is like the ongoing thing that you hear. Ayedio, times are hard, and that's like the oxygen we breathe now. How tough things are. How do you invest when the climate is so muddied with this times are hard issues? When we come back, we'll pick his brains on that, so that you know that within, no matter how bad it looks, there's still a way to invest and stand up straight. Stick around, we'll be right back.
The KSM Show.